Now on BBC Two, more from the RHS Chelsea Flower Show. Digital viewers can explore the show gardens by pressing the red button or through the BBC iMenu.
They dominate the Chelsea showground. They're packed with rare exotic beauties guaranteed to please. Tonight, the floral pavilions uncovered. Welcome to the Floral Pavilions here at the RHS Chelsea Flower Show. And from Antirrhinum to Xantadesia, these two huge structures are home not just to everybody's favourite plants, but also to some you'll have never seen before, the rare and the beautiful, all at their perfect best.
Well, we've all done it, haven't we, lads? Given a girl a bunch of flowers for a pure delight of her reaction. Well, you can't beat the power of flowers here at Chelsea. It's full of heartstoppers.
In the next half hour, the passion for plants is international. Dermot the Intrepid discovers rare exotica on the island of Mauritius. A plantsman's journey to Chelsea and why pelargoniums do it for one man. And if you cross Covent Garden with two women from India, what do you get? You'll have to wait and see. Well, for most of us gardeners, the reason we're out there in all weathers and up to our knees in mud isn't for the love of being cold and wet, but because come summer, we're blessed with beds full of beauties. And judging by thoughts of the visitors to the floral pavilions today, we're a country obsessed. Beware, passion for plants is big, and it could be catching. It is for these people. They all flock here. I think 155,000 of them coming here in the space of, what, 4 days. They've coped with all kinds of weather. It's rained on them. It's blown them to bits today. They watched plants suffer. And that's why these floral pavilions really are an important part. It's not all about gardens at Chelsea. It's about these men in here and the women who grow plants better than anybody else in the world. Make no mistake about it, Chelsea is the best flower show in the world, and they come here from all over the place just to be a part of it. You can't actually take anything away with you, but what you can do is order it. And they love it if you do that.
It's an addiction. I don't know why it is, but it is.
These are two of my auriculas here. Loxy, which is a double auricular yellow, which is quite different because it has red patches in the petals. This is another one called Kevin Keegan. I love them both. I prefer the doubles because I've got a collection of over 140.
It's like a drug. You need all the colours. You want all the types. It really is something. It gets into you.
What I love about climbing plants is the diversity. These plants are perhaps the most aggressive in terms of competition and getting to the light and surviving. This one is actually named after my 5-year-old daughter Molly. It's as bright and glorious as she is.
I think the most important thing about grasses really is their shape and form, the individual structure they've got, the personality that they have. I've been collecting grasses probably for about 10 years or so now, and I now list over 200.
I can't imagine a life without bulbs. It's so much part of my life. It would be very dull for me. It's the seasons that are always told by the bulbs, from the first snowdrops right through to the summer lilies, back into the autumn crocus. Every month there's a bulb coming out, something new.
I have a passion for vegetables. I feel that vegetables haven't got the right status within the horticultural sphere. I mean, flowers are dominant, roses, orchids. You can't eat them anyway. This was a hobby 8 years ago, a hobby that has gone sadly out of control because the leeks will have to be a dominant factor. And the onions is a challenge to grow them big. And the long carrots are another one.
proud man. Well, British gardeners don't have a monopoly on this great passion for plants, you know. It's a truly international phenomenon. There are several foreign exhibitors here this year, from Denmark to Ecuador, and no country is too small. When Dermot heard about the rare exotica being rescued by the Mauritius Horticultural Society, well, he just had to take a look for himself.
One and a half thousand miles off the southeast coast of Africa, in the middle of the Indian Ocean, lies an island the size of London. Known as an exotic holiday destination, Mauritius is surrounded by 100 miles of white sandy beaches and the world's third largest coral reef.
But what most tourists don't realise is that this island is home to some of the rarest plants in the world. And this year, some of them are coming to Chelsea.
Because of its isolated position and temperate climate, the plant life on Mauritius has been left to its own devices since the island's volcanic beginnings 8 million years ago. Species have evolved here that are found nowhere else on Earth. This unusual Dictyospermum, with its conjugated leaves, is one of only a handful living in the wild. Hidden from view halfway up this waterfall, a small flower called Nessoconda mauritiumum lives in a total habitat the size of a snooker table. The ancestors of this amazing Hyophorbe americalis palm have been living on the island for millions of years. If you sailed west to Africa when this plant's forebears first grew here, you'd find some very clever apes just beginning to come down from their trees.
But just 5 centuries ago, the European ancestors of those very clever apes discovered Mauritius for the first time from their trade ships. And that's when things began to go very wrong.
You've heard the story of Mauritius' most famous resident, the dodo. The flightless bird was driven extinct by the European sailors who found it all too easy to catch for food. But it's not just the animal life that suffered extinction at the hands of human settlers. During the last 4 centuries, Mauritius has lost a massive amount of its unique flora. Today, just 1% of the island's original forest remains. That palm is the last left in the world.
But over the last 10 years, the Mauritius National Parks and Conservation Services have taken over the responsibility for halting and, in fact, reversing the decline in the indigenous plant species.
Many of the plants we'll be seeing in the Mauritius exhibit at Chelsea this year were thought to be extinct and have only recently been rediscovered high in the mountains or on remote islands like this one, the Isle aux Aigrettes, which is now protected and a no-go area for tourists.
We've had to get special permission to land on the island from the government and from Ashok, who's the general manager of the island. He's going to show me some of the conservation success stories and make sure I don't trample on any of the endangered species.
With the dodo, Mauritius has lost many species of animals and plants. Now, our main objective is to preserve all that we still have. We are restoring this island, we are removing the exotic species, and we are replacing all these with native vegetation, all the rare species. This island is going to become a living museum for the very rare species. This island finally will become what it looked like 400 years ago before man landed here.
In Mauritius and its surrounding islands, dozens of species unseen for decades have been rediscovered and, through intensive propagation, brought back from the brink of extinction. The decline of this unique and beautiful plant life has been halted, and the gardeners of this country are keen to show their success to the horticultural world. Devi Virasamy of the Mauritius Horticultural Society educates islanders on plant conservation, and this year she's planning to educate us at Chelsea by incorporating endangered plants into her exhibit.
Thanks to the devoted efforts of members of the Mauritius Horticultural Society, visitors to the Chelsea Flower Show this year will get a chance to see a host of plants that the world has never seen before.
Oh, Well, you certainly looked after me very well in Mauritius. You've arrived safely, obviously, in London. Did all your plants come safely?
Yes, all my plants come safely without any damage.
Excellent. And you've enjoyed building the display. Rajan, what's the main reason for bringing such a fantastic display of exotic
plants? So, as you see, all the flowers have very bright colors and very attractive. Most of the people who came to the stand, they have appreciated the colors and we want to show all the people what kind of hybrids and many different colors we are growing in Mauritius.
And are you telling them about conservation, why it's important to look after these plants?
Yeah, some of the plants are like endemics that never have been exposed in the Chelsea Flower Show. This time we have brought, and they are very attractive. They are very decorative by leaves and even very rare plants.
But it's not only older varieties of those, because there's some newer ones which are also breeding DV.
Yes.
Tell me about this one.
But this is they call it Chico, and this is the very small, you know, to show the tourist and to offer when the tourists come to Mauritius.
Ah, lovely.
And for the buttonhole also.
So it's a real plant of welcome.
Yes.
And what has the reaction been that you're getting from people around?
So reactions from people, most of the people coming on this stand, they have appreciated, and most of the people want to order.
I don't blame them, it's a beautiful place.
Yes. Yes,
thank you very much.
Okay.
Makes you pine for it, doesn't it? Well, there's only half an hour left in the final heat of the BBC RHS People's Awards to choose your favourite garden. Today's heat winner will go forward to the final showdown, with the winner being announced tomorrow evening. Yesterday's finalist was the wonderful world of koi, and today's five gardens are...
The treehouse garden is inspired by the design styles of Bali. A curved stone staircase with water running down rills leads to the main deck. Planting is lush, with the aim of achieving a subtropical feel. A circular stone gate leads into the centre of the Shearman Shea Celtic Sanctuary Garden. Four stone thrones surround a steaming water feature and a central bowl of fire. The plants have been chosen for their healing properties and symbolism in Celtic lore. The Healing Garden is dedicated by His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales to the memory of his grandmother, Queen Elizabeth the Queen Mother. A curved limestone path leads to a traditionally constructed wattle and daub shelter. The planting includes 125 native British plant species, including many with a medicinal or culinary use. Reflections on a Tatashina Meadow aims to contrast east and west, old and new. A modern wooden deck overlooks a Japanese meadow, with many of the species found on the Tatashina Plain. These plants are also recognised as the main ingredient of many British gardens. The Prairie House and Garden aims to bring a piece of North American history to Chelsea 2002. The garden scene contains structures and plants that would have been found in 13th century America, and the planting includes cultivated vegetables and crops such as tobacco and corn. If you're a digital viewer and want to see any of the five gardens in more detail, just press the red button on your handset to take an interactive tour.
You can vote on the BBC website or by telephone. Calls are charged at the national rate. The lines will close at 8:45, so you've just half an hour to make your choice. Now, then, most of us have, at some time, fallen for a flower. Every year I come to Chelsea, my fickle heart gets tempted, but I'll reveal my true love a bit later in the programme, sorry. And yet, not many of us would downsize our careers just to devote more time to one plant, however dear. It must have been infatuation, then, for this man.
Every inch of Derek Lloyd Dean's six greenhouses is packed with plants. Well, one plant, actually, the pelargonium.
The beauty of the actual plant, why I like it, is A, it's easy to grow, B, you've got a mass of different colours, different sizes to suit all types of gardening. If you want it in your porch or on your windowsill or in the patio, there is a plant to suit you. I suppose the first sight I had of them was really my mother grew them. They would always be called her geraniums, and if you said to Mother, well, they're not their pelargoniums, well, you didn't argue with Mother, really. She said they were geraniums, and that was it.
Geraniums are hardy, many native to Britain. Pelargoniums are from warmer climes.
They are basically from South Africa, so they like the nice warm climate, and they will not take a heavy frost. So if you plant it out in the garden, they will die.
Derek grows all four types of pelargonium: zonals with the distinctive leaf markings, scented leaf varieties, regals, and the national collection of angels.
I felt that if you were going to get involved in like national collections, we were all a load of nutters, and I think that just about sums it up, because it's very time consuming. I think we're now up to between 80 and 90 different varieties of angels. My wife says it's a few more, but yeah, we have a few arguments about this, but I'm not going to argue with her too much, because she'll hit me around the ear.
Thankfully for Derek, those arguments stem from a shared passion for pelargoniums.
I've always liked pelargoniums. There's just so many different varieties and different types that there's always new ones coming in. It is just a nice hobby, really. I prefer taking the cuttings and seeing them grow. It's nice to see how they finish, but I like the beginnings.
And what makes a prize pelargonium for Chelsea?
I have here two regal pelargoniums, right? One is a very old variety going back to about 1925 called Carisbrook. Very big, lots of buds, as you can see, super plant, lovely soft pink. But the habit of the plant leaves a lot to be desired. The modern cultivar tends to be like that. Masses and masses of colour, masses of flower, stays very compact. This is what the modern breeder is trying to do.
Or, like Derek, you could just get out a sharp pair of scissors.
If you've got a little plant like we have here, now to get that plant very bushy, one of the shortcuts you can take is just get a pair of scissors like we have here and just trim around the plant like so. So you get the shape that you require, and then when it wants to flower, it'll flower and you'll end up with a plant not too dissimilar to that.
Derek gave up a career as an industrial chemist and became a driving instructor so he could spend more time with his plants. But at Chelsea, he's still an amateur competing with the commercial nurseries.
The difficulty that we have is space and equipment, really. I only last year managed to get electricity laid on into these greenhouses. It was too costly. So we had to really rely on Mother Nature. If the sun came out, terrific. If it came out too much, then we'd have to get on the roof with old sheets, netting, anything. So we have to do as the amateur does. Just pray and hope it all works.
He makes the trip to Chelsea, still dreaming of gold.
We take all the seats out of the espace, and I probably for Chelsea have to do 6, 7 or 8 trips with the plants.
But for Derek, it's worth the effort.
It's a typically British day out. We moan because we queue, but we turn up the following year. We moan because it rains, we turn up the following year. If it's a nice day, if the sun is shining, we're sitting out on the grass, we're enjoying the flowers. I've always been a Chelsea holic. I love Chelsea. It's got everything going for it.
What a wonderful family scene that was. It shows that it's real people here, doesn't it? How many journeys then, Derek? How many van loads?
This year I did 8 trips coming up here to get everything up.
Can I make a suggestion? It may sound a bit earth-shattering to you, but could you not just hire a bigger van and do it once?
You should have mentioned that before the show, you see.
No.
You see, if you touch your brakes with a big van, everything in the van just piles up behind you, so yeah, it's no good at all. So you want lots of little shelves. I haven't got time to do that, you know.
All right, I'll let you off. Okay. Now, I noticed in that film, you've got one of my favourite pelargoniums, and I grow it at home, and it's that one up in the back corner, Pelargonium Ardennes.
Yes, yeah, lovely, isn't it?
Tiny flower, really, really rich red, though.
Yeah. Beautiful flower, but the leaves are pretty yuck because they got very, very large leaves, sort of like dock leaves, really. And we hide the leaves behind there so you can't see them. The flower is absolutely gorgeous. And you have to treat it a little bit like a dahlia, really. Little tubers underneath when you take your cutting, so you've got to get those out. And
so
the amateur finds
fiddly.
A bit difficult. Yeah, 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 but it's a superb plant.
Well, there you are then, in the middle of all your babies, which is the old chestnut of a question, I suppose, but
yes,
which is the pelargonium grower's favourite? You know, if you know what it is.
Well, that's with lots of fun. But the one at the moment I like is the basket plant we got in front here called
called Michael, which is super for hanging baskets, an angel pelargonium in from America, very, very deep cut leaf, and it performs very well.
How many of the 12 months does that flower for then?
That'll go from around about mid-April right through to around about September, right the way through the summer months. If you keep deadheading, keep feeding, it'll keep going.
On a really stocky plant?
Yes. Yes.
So, are you still addicted to Chelsea after the show?
I'm a Chelsea-holic, yes, I love it here. It's got everything going for us, and I think it's an absolutely superb show. Brilliant, you know, great fun, love the people, love the atmosphere.
Well, we hope you'll keep coming, and I will save up for a van with lots of little racks in it.
Thank you very much.
Cuts the journey down, and you don't get them behind your ears.
Appreciate that, very nice.
Not at all. Now here's Rachel.
Now, I usually plonk my bunch in a vase, but tucked away here in Ranelagh Gardens are two tents dedicated to the art of flower arranging. In 1948, the RHS introduced flower arranging and floristry, and it was greeted with snobbery and outrage. It wasn't until the 50s that the critics began to accept it as art. That's all history. Today, the floral tents are a big draw for visitors and exhibitors alike. Last week, two women from India flew in specially to Britain to exhibit here.
Come to exhibit for the Chelsea Flower Show in the Flower Rangers Pavilion. The topic which we've been given is Gardens of the World. So instead of doing a luscious garden or a garden which is like a tropical garden, we chose to show a garden which was beautiful once upon a time, but which, because of neglect, has come to a state of decay.
While the water gardens of Rajasthan provide the inspiration, New Covent Garden of Nine Elms provides the flowers. Mrs. Poddar and Mrs. Basu are in search of a little slice of India to serve up at Chelsea.
We want flowers which actually look alike to the ones that we have in the country. It's difficult to bring them from India. Once you have a lot of fumigation problems and fumigation certificates. And the other thing is that travelling time is so much that we're not sure whether it'll last and stay as fresh. We hope to find the targets, and the roses, and the foliage, and then the golden rods. But this is kind of a list, mental list that we had made out before we came here. You don't need the very big ones because
they are not that.
They don't look so natural. Can we have a look at these?
Yes.
See, this is nice. It's got a beautiful yellow. Well, we did manage to pick up quite a few of the interesting things, and we always, as usual, buy more than what we need. We're just waiting to get them together and put up our exhibit now, I think.
Yes.
You know, get the props out from
them.
The boxes and then see how they look so that we are all ready for Chelsea on Monday.
And on Monday morning, the floral pavilions in Ranelagh Gardens were alive with flower arrangers on the final furlong of their race for Chelsea glory.
The idea is that the gardens which were once very beautiful, how they are in a state of ruin right now. So just to give that impression somehow, and everything is overgrown, nothing is well kept. Things are just growing at their own free will. That's the kind of effect. We did a rough practice at home, but nothing quite like what we are planning to do here. We had to be here at 6 because the doors open at 6 and we didn't want to waste time. And we have to finish by 1. So we have to just keep within our time schedule. There's no extra time given. What is left, it's just curtains down and you just leave.
So Kavita, here we are with the finished result. Can you tell me a little bit about it?
Yes, the inspiration came from the water gardens of Rajasthan, where the water gardens were created by the kings and the princes as pleasure gardens because water has a scarcity in Rajasthan, so water played a very important part. So they would conserve water and then use it to the best of their capacity.
Now, what about the things on the stand? I mean, how much was it possible to do in India before you came here?
The props we did in India, all these, the arch, the lattice work and the pillars and the broken pillars, these were made by our members of our society. Yes. So there's a little bit of them with us here, so they don't feel kind of left out because they've not been able to come.
Now, were you happy with the flowers you found in Covent Garden?
Yes, we were very happy. We could get the right colours and the forms.
Yes.
And
beautiful. These irises are particularly
lovely. Yes, because iris was displayed in the ancient times in Indian paintings. So that's why we chose the iris.
And no medal, but are you disappointed? Or
no, we are not disappointed because it's an honour to be here, to be able to participate in Chelsea and to be invited to come over.
Well, we're honoured that you're here, so thank you for coming.
Thank you.
This is a new heuchera called Cherries Jubilee. It's among hundreds of new plants launched here this week. Their breeding takes years of patience and dedication. While the RHS conducts its own trials on thousands of new hybrids every year and only recommends the best. The breeder of this plant is the current holder of an RHS Cup for his success, but he doesn't even live here. Oregon is 6,000 miles away, and though the scenery is very American, the climate is surprisingly similar to ours. Oregon's called the nursery state, and their plants do particularly well in British gardens. Dan Himes has sold millions of new plants in Europe, though created at his nurseries near Portland. As a young man, he bred fish. Then he discovered herbaceous perennials.
The secret to my success, I think, is having the eye and knowing what excites people, recognizing what I call the wow factor in a plant.
Current wows include Heuchera purple petticoats, Heucherella burnished bronze, Heucherella kimono, Tiarella spring symphony, and Geum fireball.
In my breeding, I think we're after the perfect plant, one that has so many great points, having the foliage, having the flower blooming for a very long period, and adding just a lot of joy, a lot of texture. For gardens, that's what I'm after.
Dan avoids artificial genetic manipulation. He mixes and mutates plants the old-fashioned way.
It's as simple as reaching into a very small flower, removing the stamen, placing it on the pistil, transferring little bits of pollen, and we'll repeat this maybe 20 to 30 times until the cross is made.
Making a cross is just the start. Dan's staff are paid a bonus if they can spot any unusual results among the trays of seedlings.
Right here, we're seeing a lovely variegated leaf. This has never existed before, and typically this sort of mutation is one out of 10,000. The chances of our finding one that will actually go to the public is probably one in a million. They're that rare.
Rare, but not impossible. Take a look at the work Dan's doing with pulmonaria, for example.
You might look at this profusion of flower and the color and say, this is a great one. But actually, this would lose in our trials. This one's called Big Bert. What we're really seeing is a plant that looks everywhere except at you. That's a big problem.
Over at the trial beds are the new, improved pulmonarias. Dan and one of his team award flags to those they think most promising.
These are plants at their third year. This is the year they're either wonderful or they're dead. This compact habit, it is not sprawly. A lot of bracts, it's quite full. This has been blooming for months. This wins a flag. Anything else, off with its head. We may have, 50 to 100 plants flagged here. We're still going to narrow it down to three plants for introduction. We will literally go through thousands of plants to get three super plants.
These super plants undergo exhaustive laboratory tests, and if they pass these, they end up in micropropagation. Thousands of copies can be produced using this method under sterile conditions.
What we have here is one of our newest heucheras. It's called Peachy Keen. It's a variegation that no one's ever seen before. Look to see this at Chelsea in a few years.
Also worth waiting for, a variegated Datura, which Dan says will be great for containers. A new hosta with thick leathery leaves to repel slugs, and some new begonias with stunning leaf patterns.
We have 100 rather exciting future plants. And my frustration is that the public can only accept 2 or 3 new introductions per year. This is a fabulous plant called Podophyllum. And these are the May apples, which We have some Native American species. Most of these come from the Himalayas and China. And underneath the leaf, they have these incredible burgundy flowers. They're just terrific. And I have come up with the name Kaleidoscope.
The right name is critical to a plant's success, believes Dan. Chocolate chip is one of his, as is plum pudding, cotton candy, apple frost, rhubarb pie. I feel a pattern developing here.
I've actually gotten a lot of trouble. I've named a number of things after food, and of course I don't know why that would happen. But people said, Dan, you've really got to stop naming things after food. And so I started naming a few things like hot date and black negligee. I mean, there are other passions in life.
Rob Hardy's a British nursery man who's taken delivery of many of Dunheim's new plants. So what's on here, Rob, that's come from Oregon?
Well, we've got quite a few heuchers on here. We've got Vale of Passion just here, and round the back we've got Cherries Jubilee and some heucherellas.
There seems to be a great desire for these really dark-leaved ones, doesn't there? They're the ones that sell.
They are, because they give you some wonderful colour, and they set off other plants as well with the foliage.
Why are they such a valuable race? I mean, they're not hugely showy. You know, it's going to be a bit like hostas, isn't it? We've got hundreds and hundreds of hostas. Are we going to get hundreds and hundreds of heuchers and heucherellas as well?
We have got quite a few at the moment. We've spent the last 10 to 12 years breeding all these. But they are all different. If they aren't different, we won't stock them anyway.
Why are they so good?
When he did his breeding program, he actually tested them out anywhere from Canada right down to Mexico. And they were truly tested as garden plants before he put them on the market. Unless that happens, we are not prepared to sell them anyway, because we want plants that will actually survive when they go in people's gardens.
And they are nifty in that they will survive in a part of our gardens where most things curl at their toes and die.
Well, he has done a little bit of breeding side on that as well, because he's actually crossed heucheras with tearellas. The tearellas will grow in dry shade quite happily. And by crossing the tearella with a heuchera, he's come up with heucherella, which will grow in both conditions. And most people that come to us are struggling with dry, shady conditions, especially with the dry summers we've had recently. And they will grow quite happily in those conditions.
How much does a name sell a plant? I mean, as you say, we've got Vale of Passion down here, Petite Pearl Fairy. Clearly neither of them named after you, Rob.
No.
So does a name sell a plant?
It does, but unfortunately it sells it in the wrong way sometimes, because people buy it and just buy it for the sake of the name of the plant and plant it in the wrong position. As you said on your programmes, you must plant the right plant in the right conditions, as otherwise it won't have much chance to survive.
You've been coming to Chelsea as an exhibitor for quite a long time now. When people come to your stand nowadays, are they better informed and better educated in terms of plants than they used to be?
Yes, they are, but they still want more knowledge.
So the quest for knowledge is there?
The quest for knowledge is all the time, especially about plants and what plants will grow in what conditions.
So presumably it's more fun to sell to them now than it used to be.
It is, because you aren't selling to them, you're satisfying a need they've got. So they're giving you the conditions, and then you start talking to them about the plants will go in those conditions.
And you've got more and more new plants to come, presumably, over the next few years. What's on its way from Oregon that we haven't got yet?
We have got a list. We're waiting for the pictures at the moment, but we hope to get some of that stock in this year, ready for Chelsea 2003.
And are you good at picking winners?
Rosie is.
Your wife?
My wife.
You always leave it to the wife, eh?
I do.
Most husbands do. I should be in trouble over that, you know, won't I? It's Upper Statish now, and the crowds are sort of going. They're still lingering, some of them. Should have gone half an hour ago. And with all these overstuffed gardens filled with plants, it's very interesting, because wildlife begins to take over at this time of night, doesn't it?
As we were going into the floral pavilion there, we passed the UK Growers stand, which is full of fruit and veg, and it looks absolutely fantastic. And there was a wood pigeon surveying. It was a bit like, you know, the owl on the Dursley's house in Harry Potter.
Yes.
Surveying all below him, waiting for all the crowds to move out.
He was straight down on the lettuces. Yeah, they get pests even at Chelsea Flower Show. Well, the other interesting thing is that the Sheikh's garden,
yeah,
on the main avenue down here, they've got these wonderful hornbeams growing over this central lake there, this canal, and in one of them, a blackbird has started to nest. Now, this must be a bit of a conundrum for them. Look at that, there it sits in its little nest. Now, that garden's got to be broken up tomorrow, which, of course, faces them with a bit of a problem. Do they move the blackbird, or, you know, do they have to leave it growing in there? But The even greater conundrum is that their garden is immediately opposite the RSPB's garden, you see. So if they try and move it, the RSPB are going to say, you can't do that. And I reckon they're certainly going to say, you can't do that, because the RSPB will be jealous that it didn't nest in their garden, won't they? So it's, you can't win here,
really. That's Chelsea.
Coming up, the creation of a new hybrid in garden design, plants as art. Foxgloves, a new look at an old favourite in the digital age. And keeping the aspidistras flying, houseplants through the decades. It's all right being cutting edge and up to the minute, but sometimes, particularly in gardening, you've just got to give in to sentiment and cast your mind back to those first memories of flowers in your childhood. And that's where sweet peas come in for me, because my granddad grew them on his allotment, and I've got a fond little photo of me in baggy bloomers holding his hand, and he's got a walrus moustache, and we're walking up between these rows of sweet peas, and there are Cadbury's cocoa tin lids dangling there, glinting in the sun to frighten away the sparrows. And I reckon I can still smell the sweet peas in that photograph. So for me, it's almost the last flower I would give up in my garden. And you come here to a stand like Diane Sewell's and you just go, oh, it's magic. And it takes you back all those dozens of years to your childhood when you were only that big. And you can pick a variety that's a colour you like with a powerful fragrance and that brings back with its name happy memories. I suppose this year it's going to be that one up there. Nice way to be remembered, the sweet pea.
It's very difficult when you're asked to choose your very favourite flower from the host of opportunities available at the Chelsea Flower Show. I'm normally associated with the plants that we regard as the new exotic, like Dicksonias and Phormiums and Cannas and Cordylines. But for my favourite flower, I've opted for an old friend. And this is it, Viola tricolor, or heartsease, as it's commonly known. It's native to these islands, and it's an old friend because I last used it in a garden in this very place, over in the Rockbank Gardens, when I was doing a show garden. It's a beautiful little thing. Look at those colorful petals with mauves and yellows and purples. They're not the important flowers, though. The important flowers, the ones that set seed, are down near the base of the plant. And it's a handy plant because it is the parent plant of many of the common violas and pansies that we know. It's also handy because it's used in for medicinal purpose, as the name Heart's Ease suggests. And you can also eat it in salads or crystallize the petals by coating it in sugar. Really lovely.
I've been fascinated by irises ever since I was a small child, and my father grew little reticulata irises in the rockery. And just look at these tall, bearded beauties. Now, I know the flowers are fleeting, but they're still worth growing just for the architectural foliage. And when you get colours like those on Verity Blamey, it doesn't get any better than that. Or does it? Come and look at this. The black flowers of iris chrysographies are something really special, and I think this has to be my favourite.
Often in the plant world, innovation comes from experimentation and crossbreeding. From two unrelated species comes the creation of exciting new hybrid. And the same is happening in garden design. Judy Wiseman is a sculptress who specialises in the casts of children's hands and feet. And Chelsea is her first foray into garden design. Her chic garden, Plants as Art, is one of the most innovative I've seen this year and has been awarded a silver medal. So, how did you come to, as a sculptress, move over to garden design and develop this, well, this mad idea of having plants as art and hanging them on the wall?
Well, I was in the garden centre and I saw some astelias lying on the ground, and they looked so fantastic. They looked like a painting. And I thought, wouldn't it be great if we could just kind of pick them up and put them there?
And they are, I suppose, a very sculptural plant in themselves. So you think that we should look at things in a different way?
You can think, I don't know, you look at things how you want, but that's how I do, I suppose. The shapes, yeah, the leaf shapes and the colours and the textures all look exciting altogether.
So you've brought this garden to Chelsea, you got in contact with them and said, I want to put pictures on the wall made up of plants. So how did they react?
Well, actually, they invited me to apply, and I couldn't believe it. And I thought, well, I will then. I'll apply if they're inviting me. They seem fine.
And show me how it works now. Okay. So we have those two panels on the wall. You're going to press a button. It's real Doctor Who-ish.
Yeah, really.
Look at that. All the planting are resipt to you. How long ago did you come up with this idea?
It's about 3 years ago.
Right.
And I've had
have you
one
been experimenting
at home
with different ways?
Yeah, I've tried the astelias and the cordyline seem to work really well. They seem to like it a lot. I think the box and the chamomile I've just tried now, and they seem to also be responding really well.
It's nice because you get different textures. It's a different way of showing off plants, and I could imagine orchids growing out of mossy bits would look really fantastic. And then to do it to raise it, you just push in the button and it comes up like that. Now, how about maintaining the plants?
Well, it makes it really easy like this because I have them on the wall for when we want to be out and eating and enjoying them.
Right.
But then when we go in, make them horizontal and they enjoy being in the fresh air. And
what's the reaction to it? It is something new, and often new ideas can get somewhat of a hostile reception, you know, maybe from judges, but certainly from members of the public. How are people taking to it?
Well, they laugh and they say, oh, wow. A lot of people just walk past and hadn't kind of realised. But I think they like it.
Well, I think if you've created any garden that makes people smile and laugh, you've done your jobs, and it is truly new. I think it's fantastic.
Thanks
well
so
done.
So much. Thanks.
Just like the fast-changing fashion industry, plant breeders understand the importance of coming up with something just a little different for a show. Time was when white flowers were a must in every border. They were the supermodels of the floral catwalk. They're about to be toppled by fresher talent. Chris Beardshaw struts his stuff among the rising stars.
Most gardeners are looking for a dark plant to provide wonderful colour contrast in the garden. The first thing they turn to is this, Ophiopogon plancicarpus nigrescens. It's commonly known as the black grass. Although it's a bit misleading because it's not actually a grass, it's a member of the lily family. This is a great plant to use, but it's not the only black plant you can choose. On the British market is a plant that's set to take UK gardeners by storm. It's actually a native of America. It's related to the sweet potato, and it loves sun. It's called Ipomea blacki, and believe it or not, this plant is the number one selling foliage plant in the whole of America. And literally, the more sun you give it, the blacker it gets. Unlike the tulip, the iris has a naturally occurring gene which promotes dark flowers. And if you're looking for a dark iris, you can't beat this one on the hardest stand. Collected from China, it's called Iris Chrysograph Black.
Time, they just need a fresh approach. Chris Collins is a newcomer to the gardening TV fraternity and is soon to be seen in his own series. He has a novel way of dealing with one of my old favourites, foxgloves.
If you'd have said to me when I was a child the word foxglove, I would have thought cottage, Miss Marple, scones, all that sort of thing. Since then I've become a gardener, I've had the pleasure of working with these plants, and despite their shy and sensitive nature, I think they're absolutely beautiful and deserve a spot in anybody's garden.
This is the Botanic Nursery, the Wiltshire home of the National Foxglove Collection. It's been lovingly established by Terry Baker over the last 25 years.
So, Terry, why are you in love with foxgloves?
Well, love is a bit too strong a word, perhaps, but I have a great devotion for them.
I mean, they can be quite seductive. As I say, they've got the elegance. They've not been overbred like so many florist flowers, so they're pretty much the same as they were thousands of years ago.
Why the name foxgloves?
In German medieval myth, the foxglove flower would act like a little mitten for the fox, and therefore he could sneak up on the chicken coop.
So basically the name comes from a crafty way for a fox to nick chickens without getting captured. That's where it comes from.
I think that's it.
That's excellent.
There are hundreds of varieties from all over the world here.
They like the room. They are sort of fine-spreading flowers. And I think to go with it, we'll select this rather good apricot.
Yep.
But it's not just intrepid plant hunters who supply Terry with new varieties. One of his favourites was discovered just down the road.
Sort of this sort of thing, which is, you know, a packet of seeds and recovers. This is such a good gardening story, isn't it?
Absolutely. Well, this is primrose, and this is a foxglove that was thought to be lost to cultivation until a packet of seed was found in the bottom drawer of a bureau, dated 1967.
So this plant has been grown from a packet of seeds that was in the bottom of a drawer from the same year that I was born, you're telling me.
Well, the seed lasts a long time.
Coming here reminds me why I think foxgloves deserve a home in everybody's garden.
I used foxgloves quite a lot in the mountains in Japan and amongst silver birch, and I sort of came to have a theory about why I like them. And basically, they sit there all winter, they kick through the winter, they swerve the cold, so I give them bonus for common sense straight away. And then come the spring, they produce these tight crowns and you don't know they're there, they mean nothing to you. And they bide the time and all of a sudden they'll rise above the understory with these great spikes of flower and basically say, right, it's my turn, I'm here. For that little period of showmanship, I think foxgloves have got to be worth planting.
In the natural woodland setting, foxgloves look fantastic, but they don't need a vast garden. Terry says they can look equally seductive and grow just as well on a balcony or patio.
Is there another way I can grow foxgloves? Can they be grown like this in a container?
You know, you can have a range of foxgloves in a pot on your balcony or terrace, and those will flower for you through most of the summer. And if you keep them dead-headed, just sort of cutting back the old stems, you'll get regrowth from the base, which will continue
to
show up.
So that's the secret, to get a continual flush. And then I can plant lobelia and stuff around the edge just to almost give a bedding display.
Let your imagination run wild.
Sure. This is a classic old story, isn't it? The two gardeners looking for a gardening book. Like, sound like two dirty old men looking for a dirty mag. Look at the petals on that.
Yes.
With only a few days to go, it's time to stake up the foxgloves and get them ready to travel. I'm particularly taken with this one.
Well, this is a beautiful plant, and I must say what I like about it is all this, the way it's going for it on the side as well as the top. I think people tend to think with foxgloves you have this one spire, but this one's proven us wrong. How curtain twitchy are you towards the end? Are you running in? How much cold sweat's involved?
Very little sweat, hopefully.
But,
I remember laying in bed two or three nights ago, and there was quite a gale brewing up. And there's always this fine line, you know, do you get out of your nice warm bed? Of course I did.
And you do?
And yes, I did, absolutely. One or two had blown over, so it's just as well I had. Just
brilliant. What emotions do you feel when they're all up there, all doing the business?
It's the reaction of the show visitors when they see foxgloves. Everybody loves foxgloves, but when they see them en masse like that, they just go, wow.
That's the moment where you think, I know why I got up when it was battering with rain and wind.
Well, yeah, I mean, just for a few days, you know, we're in showbiz.
Yeah, brilliant.
It looks like an occasion where a showbiz gamble paid off then.
Well, this is what intrigued me about it when I met Terry, who grows these, was no freezers or artificial lighting involved in this. He does everything naturally, and I was curious about as much of a gamble he took in order for this to pay off.
How's it changed your attitude to foxgloves?
Mainly, it's a much broader subject than we realise. People say foxglove, they'll think of purpurea, they'll think of a normal one, but actually there's quite a lot of varieties from lots of different places. It's a bit like somebody saying, how's my bamboo? Well, there are hundreds of bamboos. Well, actually, if you look at foxgloves, it's a deeper subject than you imagine.
Now, what about you, Chris? Is this your first Chelsea?
No, it's not. I actually built a garden a few years ago for one of this year's gold medal winners, Stevie Woodham.
Oh, the Merrill Lynch garden, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, and I built an organic vegetable garden with him. So I've seen the mania that goes on behind this and all the work that's gone in, but obviously it pays off because look around us.
Well, you're going to have to get used to it because you're about to hit the TV screens in a new series about Plantsmen.
Yes, I am, yeah. It's going to be... Basically, what I'm looking at doing is trying to get as many people into plants as we can. And a good anecdote for this is the fact that I remember being in Moscow and I met a botanist in Moscow and we didn't speak any mutual language, so we had this big game of charades about plants. And that I'm looking to achieve that through the vehicle of a programme, hopefully.
You will. And the one thing you will find is when you go in gardening as a TV presenter is that the people who come and watch you when you're filming, they're ever so friendly, aren't you?
Yes!
Prove me point, isn't it?
Totally.
The lines are now closed for voting in the heats of the BBC RHS People's Awards, but we do have the heat winners who will go forward to tomorrow's final vote. So here are the final gardens.
On Monday, you voted for the Goodwill Garden, which aims to recreate a picture of rural life in the West Midlands before intensive farming. Native and ornamental moisture-loving plants surround a pond, and an old tractor reflects the former use of a barn. On Tuesday, your favourite was the Garden of Elevation, which is dominated by a clear globe water feature that appears to float in the middle of the garden. Natural and loose planting provide a contrast to the circular architecture. On Wednesday, you picked the wonderful world of koi. An English rock garden surrounds a pond full of koi carp and is complemented by the flora and fauna of a Japanese garden. Today you voted for the treehouse garden, which is inspired by the design style of Bali. A curved staircase with water running down rills leads to the main deck. Planting is lush with the aim of achieving a subtropical feel. If you're a digital viewer and want to see any of the four gardens in more detail, just press the red button on your handset to go interactive.
There's more information on those gardens on the BBC's interactive service or on the website, and you can vote by telephone or online. Lines will close at 2:55 tomorrow afternoon, and the winner will be announced in tomorrow night's programme.
Houseplants are the designer accessory of today, with orchids currently top of the indoor plant pops. But what about in times gone by?
Well, believe it or not, certain plants were pretty hip even then. In the 19th century, Victoria was queen, but the aspidistra was king. Known as the cast iron plant because it was virtually impossible to kill, it was considered a symbol of middle-class respectability. Parlour palms also gave life to dark, dusty corners. By the 1930s, it was thoroughly modern to have a flowering plant to vacuum round. Aspidistras regained popularity in the 50s. The members of one old people's club were such fans they organised a whole show dedicated to them. But they don't look particularly happy about it, do they?
The sexual revolution beckoned in the 60s, opening the way for rubber in British homes.
I think we have to have a word or include the rubber plant, don't we?
Well, what did you think I meant? Frankly, we British couldn't get enough.
12 dozen plants? What the heck would you want with 12 dozen plants?
I reckon I'd want my head seen to.
Britain went cheesy in the 70s. Cheese fondue was the in thing, and cheese plants had mysteriously made their way from tropical rainforests to suburban semis everywhere.
Why are the leaves ripped like the bodice of a panting contessa? That, my inquisitive friends, is part of the fascinating mystery of the Swiss cheese.
Shoulder pads were big and greed was good, but the top plant of the 80s was something small and expensive. A bit like someone we know and love.
Are you really going to convince me that even a bimbo like me could do this kind of thing?
Yes, indeed. You don't have to be a young child to start bonsai. You can learn from quite an old age.
Japanese bonsai trees became the cutting edge of fashion even for old age newcomers like Mr. T.
Yuccas were also thought rather yummy, except by Terry Wogan.
I must say, always treasure this. Thank you. See if I can get rid of it.
Bang up to date now, and the most popular trend in trendy houseplants is without doubt the orchid. Now you can see here on the Diva Orchid stand how beautifully they work in a modern setting. But Dave, they're incredibly hard to look after, aren't they?
Absolutely not. Now with modern central heating, there's enough ambient temperature within the room to be able to keep the flowers and keep the plants growing the way they should in the wild.
Well, cacti have never been out of fashion, and with a range of colours and shapes like this, it's really hard not to love them. They're also very low maintenance, and if you want to keep them flowering, make sure you don't water them at all between the end of October and the beginning of March, and then just water them very sparingly, about once a week. And they also need a nice, bright, sunny position. And then you might even have a display like this. Big blousy begonias, they're very much the retro trend of today. Now the ones we grow outside are likely to have bright candy coloured flowers, but indoors you're looking at the foliage, the contrast in shape and colour, and what a range, from deep purples and reds to silvers and fresh greens, and in terms of texture, everything from perfectly smooth to crinkled edges and even leaves as leathery as an elephant's ear. Well, with more than 900 species to choose from, there should be something for everyone. So whether you're a delicate little flower or have the cast iron constitution of an aspidistra, there's a houseplant to suit you and your home. They brighten up a room like nothing else, and they're a whole lot cheaper than redecorating.
Well, Rachel, it was a very promising career, yours, but after showing that antique clip of me, I'm afraid it's at an end.
It's
so thank
over.
You and goodbye.
You're very welcome.
So you're sold on orchids now, are you?
I am, actually. I learned an awful lot today, and I'm going to persevere because normally I manage to kill off all my houseplants within a matter of months, either with kindness or with neglect, I'm not sure, but they don't survive.
And yet the moth orchid, the Phalaenopsis, you reckon
beautiful.
You can keep?
I'm going to have a go with it. It's worth it.
I'm going, if I have to plump for one, it would be citrus, because you get these wonderful fruits. This is a tiny little one called citrus, or Citro Fortunella mitis now. And as you can see, you get the flowers, beautifully scented blossom, at the same time as the fruits, and they stand out during the summer. I like citrus plants, but preferably a bit bigger than that. What's your favourite houseplant?
I don't have a favourite. My producer told me I had to pick one, because I think houseplants are...
That's a plant!
Well, I don't dislike any plants. It doesn't want to be inside. It was never developed to be inside.
It's fact, it's Benjamin of the Weeping Fig.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But in this country, it can't be outside.
Huh?
It can't be outside in this country.
It's overrated, overglossed, and over Ooh. Here, and I think it's a sham. I don't like... Mind you, I do have an orchid in my showroom, and I say good morning to it every day.
You have a showroom. Do you sell cars?
A shower room.
Oh, your shower room.
Yes.
You see, how long have I worked with him now, and I still can't quite get the accent right, you know. The trouble is, I think we all became blasé about the Weeping Fig, because it was so far
it's
and away
everywhere.
It's
easy to become blasé about it. You see it in every office. The government hired him. I think they've about a cost of about 100,000 a year. They have about 12 of them in their...
In portcullis house.
Yeah. And all you see is the leaves falling off. That's all you ever see.
Yeah, that is true.
Be fair. When you're growing in an environment like that, it's a bit tough to survive. Weeping figs always shed their leaves when you move them.
Let me finish.
And in a big open
space... want to be outside. They do not want to be in our houses.
This weeping fig, it's from the tropics. It doesn't want to be outside here in December.
It doesn't want to be here at all.
No, you're probably right.
That's not the cue.
He's always very handy if you want a bit of controversy, isn't he? All you have to do is to ask him to do something, and he says no, and he's so predictable, bless his heart. I'll tell you, I'm going to send you, not this little squat one here, but I'm going to send you a decent-sized orange that you can stand outside in summer on your terrace, and you will be enamoured when
too?
You slice a lemon.
Can I have one?
I tell you, there's nothing finer than picking a lemon. You can have one for your London garden, made available.
I'd love one.
You can have one for your London garden, and you slice the lemon off in summer, drop a bit into your G&T, and it's the biggest swank for the neighbours.
Can I have one for Harlesden?
Of course you can. They even grow in Harlesden. That's how good-natured they are, these citrus plants. Well, we've got another day of this tomorrow, haven't we?
Yep.
Last day tomorrow.
Yeah.
Exciting. Yeah, but we've had a good time, really, so I hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have. So, it's supported, as you know by now, by Merrill Lynch Investment Managers. That's it from the Chelsea Flower Show tonight. You can see more coverage with Chris Bearshaw and Charlie Dimmock tomorrow afternoon at 2:10 on BBC One. We bump into them in the middle of the afternoon sometimes.
Occasionally.
We all run around this showground, you know. We sometimes say hello to one another in passing.
John, the afternoon never says hi to me.
We never watch their programme, of course, because we're busy doing ours. But we will be back tomorrow with the results of the RHS People's Award. Same time, 8 p.m, BBC Two. Till then, from all three of us, ta-da.
Bye.
Don't forget that you can take part in the BBC RHS People's Vote by logging on to BBCi at bbc.co.uk/gardening.
If you've got digital TV, you can dig up even more ideas from the Chelsea Flower Show via BBC iYou can take an interactive tour of the show gardens and find out more about the featured plants. Press the text button on your remote now to start exploring. The RHS Chelsea Flower Show, live and interactive. It could plant some ideas in your head. For more information on receiving the interactive service for the RHS Chelsea Flower Show, call 08700 100 789 or log on to the web.